Market Deeping is a lovely town on the southern edge of Lincolnshire, just outside Peterborough. And it has some superb characteristics. It's got lovely stone buildings, it's got a superb church, but most of all, it's got lovely people. And St. Guthlac's, the church, which has been here for hundreds of years, is just like that too. It is a microcosm of Market Deeping, incredibly welcoming. I was welcomed here as director of music 4 or so years ago and have really enjoyed my time with everybody here that sings in the choir, with the priests. Everybody has just been very welcoming and very enthusiastic about music in the church, music in worship, music as part of the community. The trouble was that when I came, the organ was in a pretty poor state. Everybody recognised it was in a pretty poor state, but there wasn't the understanding of what it involved to do what was necessary. I'd been through that process before in another church and talked to the rector about what was necessary. So over a period of time, we developed an understanding within the team, leadership team, within the PCC, and then the wider congregation of what was necessary to get this wonderful 1882 instrument back into fine fettle. That takes time. You can't do that quickly. People have to understand that it costs an inordinate amount of money. You have to think about whether it's actually worth doing or whether it's cheaper to bring in an electronic instrument and all of those things. But it's an 1882 hill. It has a pedigree. Yes, it's been altered over the years, but it is still in essence an 1882 hill. So it was worth doing something with. We knew that, for example, the leather on the bellows was likely to fail at any day, and that makes an organ completely useless. So the bellows being in the root, the very base of the instrument, everything has to be taken apart to get it out. At that point, it becomes possible to do all sorts of other things with an instrument. PCC obtained quotes. We had a whole variety of options. We chose a contractor that gave us a number of options for enhancing the instrument, enhancing the sound it makes, enhancing the volume that it can carry through. Because one of the issues always, since it was built in 1882, is that it's not had sufficient volume. So with all of that, we chose Clevedon Organs UK. Anthony Hall, the director, came and gave a very comprehensive list of options that we could think about.
The organ was built at the end of the 19th century by William Hill, a very famous London builder. And subsequently, like most organs, it's evolved through its history. People have made subsequent alterations to make it conform to the standards of the time. And this has happened to this organ quite extensively. As part of dismantling organs, it's rather like archaeology. You're peeling back layers and you're seeing what's original, what isn't original. More often than not, the non-original parts never quite work to the same standard as the original builder. Our job is to try and make those parts function or remove them and build something better. So it's rather like an old house that evolves through the centuries with bits sort of added on. And every organ tells a story. Because every organ is unique. The total number of pipes in this particular organ is 738. It's a musical wind machine, basically. So you have a set of keys, a set of pedals that you play with your feet, and they are connected to boxes full of wind and valves, and by various means, be it mechanical transmission or electric transmission or pneumatic transmission, when you press a key, it will open a valve in this wind box, which is called a wind chest, and that lets the air into the set of pipes that you choose by drawing a stop knob, which there's for each rank of pipes, there's an individual stop knob, which is the tone colour that you choose to use. The wind is provided by a blower that goes into a bellows, and that regulates the wind pressure. And that's essentially it, although that as a composite whole, the organ is extremely complicated with tens of thousands of moving parts. So as an aggregate whole, it's quite a complicated machine.
Once everybody knew the amount of money, and we're talking of a project that was 80-odd thousand pounds in total, the congregation just took it on board. The church has a history of fundraising projects for tower refurbishment, kitchen, toilet, and so on. And the response of everybody was, well, it's got to be done. Yeah, so what? Let's do it. We appealed, or rather, the then rector appealed for fundraising ideas. And the deal was that if you had a fundraising idea, you had to be prepared to organise it. 43 ideas came up for fundraising. So we started with a sponsored hymn sing. We had 20 or 30 people here singing 100 verses of well-known hymns, sponsored per verse. I suppose you could say it's a perverse activity, but never mind. And that raised a staggering £2,500 just to set it off. And that's how it went on. We had all sorts of initiatives, from fashion shows and wine tastings, beer tastings, quizzes, all sorts of activities which raised the money. However, alongside all of that, we decided that we wanted to lodge a lottery appeal, Heritage Lottery Fund appeal, because we knew that there was a lot of money involved, and we also knew that to raise all of that money ourselves would have been quite difficult. So we lodged an application, but on the basis that we wanted the project to be educational. We wanted to involve schools, we wanted to involve the community, we wanted to involve individuals in telling the story of how an organ works, the role it has in the community, and getting youngsters involved in playing it. I was here in church, and we had a phone call from the Heritage Lottery Fund, literally while we were here in church, telling us that we've been awarded £40,000. And that did two things. First of all, it gave us a sense of relief, but it also gave us the impetus to do that last bit of fundraising to make sure that all the things we wanted to do could go ahead. So we're absolutely indebted to the Heritage Lottery Fund for that money and for enabling us to take the message of what an organ rebuild is and does, the skills involved, the music involved, out to the wider community. When Clevedon Organ's team arrived here to start the work, my emotions were all over the place. It was delight that the work was starting, horror at the state of the instrument because it was absolutely filthy. And I knew that these guys were going to get really dirty taking it apart. Intrigue because of the workings of an instrument, which I'd seen many times before, but still fascinate me with all the rodding and the wires and the cabling and all sorts of other things. But also relief that the work was finally getting underway and that in a few months' time, we knew we would have an instrument we could be proud of because we trusted the Clevedon team and still do.
Well, what we found was a typical small Victorian pipe organ with mechanical action. The start process is obviously dismantling and documenting everything, measuring, taking lots of photographs, and being very methodical in how you take the organ apart. There's a definite process to follow, a protocol. And once everything is out of the organ and laid out, we decide what to take back to the workshop, what can be tackled on site. Some parts have to remain in the church for climatic reasons because they're very old timbers. If you take them from the sort of climate of the church, which can be quite damp or indeed dry, depends, to a different environment in the workshop, that can actually damage the timbers irreversibly. So we have to pay particular attention to what we are deciding to take back. This is not a job that you can rush. You have to have infinite patience. We're also constrained by the fact that we're dealing with an antique instrument which has been modified over the years. And so you have to kind of be very sensitive to that. And you have to realise how far the organ wants to go. And in fact, in these projects, as I've said many times, the organ builder is never really in control of the process. The organ itself dictates what can be done to it within those parameters. So it's a case of having the ideal and the vision in your head of what you want to achieve and taking it as far as you can insofar that the organ will allow you to do. So it's knowing the limitations of what you're proposing to do and basically trying to get things as good as they possibly can be. The main problems with it were that it's always suffered from being quite soft, not loud enough to fill the building with sound and lead the congregation. The other side of it was that the mechanical action was very heavy to play, so the organist found it was hard on the fingers. And the organ was in a general state of disrepair. Things like the bellows needed re-leathering. The action was very worn and noisy and heavy and binding. And the pipes had been got at over many generations, attempting to get the pipes loud enough to fill the building with sound. There were lots of surprises. When we took the organ apart, we found that some of the original mechanism had been removed at some point and luckily stored underneath the organ bellows, and the opportunity arose to reinstate some of those missing parts so that there would be another area of the original organ coming back to life, and that would also improve the loudness of the organ. Visually, they will see some new fretted panels which will go in the side of the organ case, which will follow the design of the choir stalls. And the reason for that is that originally they were solid panels, and fretted panels allow the sound to come out into the main part of the building, which will make a big difference to the brightness and the sort of pervasiveness of the sound.
An organ is built up of several parts. So the pipes sit on soundboards, the soundboards are fed wind by the bellows are fed wind by the blower, basically. And the keys operate a whole series of rods and wires to make it all work. each part of that instrument is a speciality in itself. So the blower, for example, went off to the manufacturers in Derby to be refurbished. The bellows had to be completely re-leathered. They went to a workshop in Norfolk. The pipes went to a voicer and tuner in Somerset. The main workings of the organ went to a workshop also in Somerset. So we had the organ literally dispersed to the four winds.
There's a perennial problem on organs of over the course of time, the pallet spring actually cutting into the wood of the pallet, so that instead of the spring being able to move as that is, it becomes rigid and the action becomes springy and relatively unresponsive. So we've just put a little grub screw in there so that the pallet spring seats on the metal of the grub screw rather than digging into the relatively soft cedar, and it gives a nice bearing to the pallet. It only moves about that much, but that should stop that from happening and stop the touch watering over time, which is what happens. Quite often we find pallet springs in old organs have bedded their way sort of down to there and actually almost jamming the pallet one way or another. And we've covered the new cedar pallets with two layers of very, very soft white leather, and you can just see on there that the bedding line where the new pallet is seating properly. And this should give an improved touch. It should take away some of the sponginess, make it more direct and actually far more pleasant to play.
Trumpet and oboe stops were revoiced to make them more appropriate. The main stops of the organ were also revoiced to give it more power. The casework was pierced, CNC routed, to give it more penetrative power down the nave. New swell shutters were added so that the swell organ, which has shutters that open and close for volume, so that that could project better down the nave. Two electronic stops were added, and I say electronic, they're not actually electronic, they work by electronics, but they're actually using pipework to give a much deeper sound to the instrument, to add to the bass sound of the instrument. the action that makes it all work. It was rebedded, restrung, new pallets were put in soundboards, all the soundboards were refurbished, new action on the pedals, a new pedal board refurbishment, a new pedal trombone was added. So all in all, we have a wonderful 1882 instrument that's been massively refurbished and rebuilt, and now is, first of all, a joy to play, but also a joy to listen to.
Well, I actually missed all the hard work with the restoration of the organ, because when I arrived, it had all just been completed. Fortunate, I guess, for me, because I get to hear it in all its glory as it is. But I was blown away by the size of the project and how much has been involved and how much work there had been. And it's just been wonderful to know that that has taken place. It's kind of reinvigorated our worship together. The organ and music is vital for how we worship when we come together here in this church community. And I know other congregations feel the same too. It just not only enhances our worship, but it's vital to it. When we praise God, we're singing together, and we need the organ to help us to sing. It can help us feel joyful, or we can have more reflective moments. And all of that is led by the music, by the organ and our wonderful organists. And to have something restored and sounding so beautiful has made a real difference to how we are able to engage with God ourselves when we meet together.
When an organ is rebuilt, you have the opportunity for new music. And we wanted new music for this instrument that could show the versatility of the instrument, but also celebrate it. The lottery funding enabled us to commission two pieces of music. The first was from composer Alan Bullard, and that was Make a Joyful Noise Unto the Lord. The anthem was sung at the rededication service, the choir and I worked very hard to make that a really joyful noise. It's a superb anthem, published by Oxford University Press now, it really rang out and everybody loved it. In fact, we sang it again fairly soon after. The bishop came and we had a full rededication service, which was absolutely wonderful. Truly memorable, and something that everybody in the church looked forward to and celebrated.
Accept this organ, which we rededicate to you, that with the voice of music we may proclaim your praise. And now, bless this organ, we pray, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, that it may be set apart and consecrated for the praise of you. These things we ask in the name of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you, O Father, and the Holy Spirit, praise is given for ever and ever.
Amen.
Thank you.
one of the main backbones of the HLF application was to get more people involved with the organ. Because of the increase in volume of the instrument, the power of the instrument, the additional work on the casework, the organ can be heard all over the church, and it can truly lead. And that has resulted in a wonderful outpouring of gratitude for the work, of thanks, because they now realise what was missing. And it is about what was missing rather than, you know, the organ was lovely. It was a lovely instrument, difficult to play. The touch was very, very hard, very heavy, much lighter now. So it's possible to play faster things on it without pain. But people can now see and hear what they didn't realise was missing. And it can really accompany a full church, which is truly wonderful. So at Christmas and big celebrations, we can normally have huge congregations here and be uplifted by the singing and by the sound of the organ. And what you get out of it is, first of all, a joy that you can make these sounds. Secondly, a feeling of, I suppose it's power, because you are in a position where you are leading worship. But it's also terrifying, because if you get it wrong, everybody knows. The other thing is, it's about service. And you are producing something that leads everybody to a conclusion in the service. So what do I get out of it? Two things, really, mainly. The joy of playing and the feeling of the organ around you. You actually feel it vibrating through your whole body. Such is the power of the instrument. You know, you've got an awful lot of wind in here that's blowing an awful lot through pipework and making an awful lot of sound. And you feel that. And that's something, you know, that's something really good, really good. And I really love. We are absolutely delighted with the work they've done. Absolutely delighted. Couldn't have wished for better.
We're learning all the time. Every organ teaches us something different. The whole industry is driven by the fact that people are doing it because they want to do it, because they love doing it. You certainly wouldn't come into this as a viable commercial venture. People say of organ building that it's really semi-commercial, bordering on being almost a charity. There is no money to be made, and you have to take the vocation of organ building if you want to do this as a living. It's a way of life. It's a lifestyle choice. There's no shortage of enthusiasm. There's certainly, irrespective of the fact that people aren't coming into the business, there are the skills there if you can tap into them. You know, this country's produced some amazing craftsmen, and we've been lucky enough to have some of them work in the organ building industry. But what we really need is investment, and we need the enthusiasm of parishes such as St. Guthlac's, where they're really enthusiastic to do something with the organ and make it as good as it can be. And that level of enthusiasm will sustain the organ building trade. You do a 7-year apprenticeship is fairly typical. And then you basically spend the rest of your life learning on the job. And even if you've done it for 40 years, you never stop learning, which is why we keep doing it.
So yes, we have had some younger people who come to the church now interested in learning the organ when they're perhaps a little bit older than they are now and able to do so. We have a junior church called Young Explorers, and that meets for half of the service. For the second half, they come back in. And there is some people who actually, when they come back in, instead of wanting to sit with their families, they now want to come and help play the organ. So they've been able to do so by just pulling out the stops and helping in that kind of way, because they are interested in it more now, yes.